Welcome to our Radiographics podcast. I'm Jeff Klein, editor of Radiographics, and today I'm pleased to welcome Dr. Arun Nachiappan from the Department of Radiology at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia, who is one of our authors of the paper Pulmonary Tuberculosis, Role of Radiology in Diagnosis and Management, which appears in the current January 2017 issue of the journal. Arun, welcome.
Thank you.
Your article provides a very nice overview of the clinical and the imaging evaluation of patients with tuberculosis. Let's begin by providing some definitions. What is active TB, inactive TB, latent TB? How is active disease distinguished from inactive disease?
Great. Thank you. That's a great question, Jeff. First, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the co-authors who worked hard on this manuscript, and also my family, my wife and kids, for giving me time to work on this project as well. So that's a very good question. Active TB, inactive TB, and latent TB. And we're kind of using descriptions that have already been made and modifying it slightly over here. So active TB, we would think of as a patient who has an infection that progressed to disease where we're concerned that they're infectious and they're going to spread the infection to other people. And active can be divided into two types, primary and post-primary TB. And primary TB being the type of TB that somebody gets exposed, infected, and then within 1 to 2 years, they develop active infection. That's usually children or immunocompromised people like HIV patients. Now, the post-primary TB population is the one that we tend to see more when we're evaluating adult patients. And with post-primary TB, there is a reactivation of a dormant mycobacteria. And although there's some thought nowadays that sometimes the post-primary TB is actually a second strain of TB reinfection. So that would be the two types of active TB, broadly speaking. And now talking about latent TB, we talk about the mycobacteria being dormant in the patient's body. So 90% of patients who get infected with the mycobacterium will be dormant for the rest of their lives. And so we would call them as latent TB. The inactive TB is a small proportion of those latent TB patients where we're giving them a separate category because there's a slight difference in their management. So 5% of people who are exposed and infected with mycobacteria and they actually develop some amount of destruction in their lungs. And it's not clear at the time point when we see them, whether this was a previous TB that had happened in the past and is inactive. And so that's a little diagnostic dilemma when we see those patients.
Right, great, well thank you for that. So just going to the paper, figure one in the paper provides an algorithm for the evaluation of possible active TB. And then in figure 22, you provide an algorithm for the evaluation of latent tuberculosis. You know, this is really important. You know, as we, you know, radiologists, we're always commonly asked to evaluate, interpret radiographs which are obtained in patients where there's a clinical concern for tuberculosis. Can we look at figure 22 and have you take us through the algorithm, particularly what radiographic findings we should, as radiologists, should be looking for that would suggest that the patient has active disease as compared to inactive disease as is listed in table 3?
Sure. So we're looking at figure 22. And at the top of figure 22, we talk about latent TB targeted testing. And the phrase targeted testing is meant to be there just to indicate that we're not testing everybody in the whole world for latent TB, because then we would catch a lot of people who end up being positive on these tests like the tuberculin skin test or the IGRA test when it's not medically necessary to treat them. So that targeted testing means that these patients should be asymptomatic, and also they should have a high risk for exposure or reactivation. And I just want to briefly mention the high risk for exposure and reactivation because there's slight nuances between the two. The high risk for exposure patients like immigrant patients from endemic regions or patients who are drug users, people who are in high-risk facilities like nursing homes and jails and healthcare workers, these people are at high risk for exposure. Now, the high risk for reactivation part is the people who, let's say they've already been exposed and infected, what's the chance of them getting reactivation? So those people are like HIV positive patients or immunosuppressed patients, patients on TNF-alpha inhibitors, or those who have been exposed to the infection and converted in the last 2 years or less than 4 years in age. So keeping that in mind, The second box is saying that they're getting the TST or the tuberculin skin test or the IGRA, the interferon gamma release assay. Now, if it's negative, we stop over there because we don't need to further treat them or manage them. But if they get a positive test for that targeted testing, then we do a chest X-ray. And this is where the radiologist comes into play. And it's really, I think, important to recognize the slight differences in management with these three legs. So let's take the first leg on the left, the normal or calcified granuloma. So if the chest X-ray is normal, or there's just a calcified granuloma or calcified lymph node, that's considered to be the least, important you can think of. And the clinician may or may not treat these patients for latent TB. The time when they may decide to treat these patients is if they have a high risk factor for reactivation. So not the high risk factor for exposure, which got them into this algorithm, but specifically the high risk factor for reactivation. So that's where that came in. The next leg is the fibronodular changes. So with the fibronodular changes, I think that's important for us to recognize on radiograph because sometimes we have patients with biapical scarring and it's minimal and it's mostly symmetric and oftentimes thought to be related to ischemic changes. But if we detect that there's asymmetry, there's more scarring on one side, there's some other evidence like hilar retraction and traction bronchiectasis, then we should, I think, alert ourselves to think about the possibility of an inactive TB, which can present with those fibronodular changes. So the next step, once we detect that, is to decide, is that stable or not stable? And luckily, if we have a comparison chest radiograph and it's stable for 6 months, then we're going on to saying that those patients should be treated for latent TB, which is only a single drug therapy. But if we cannot establish that 6-month stability because there's a lot of problem with getting previous chest x-rays or we're not sure if it's really stable, then they should really be worked up for active TB because there could be harboring in that setting of fibronodular changes some manifestation of active TB. By workup for active TB, we're talking about getting sputum samples and testing with AFB, nucleic acid amplification test, and culture. Now, the third leg, if that turns out to be negative, then we would treat them for latent TB. But the third leg of the chest x-ray is findings are if we have a cavity or a consolidation. And if the cavity or consolidation is noted, then that should make us think more of active TB, and the patient should be worked up for active TB like we just described. One other point is interesting that if we have a cavity on the initial chest x-ray, that actually changes their management in terms of how many months of active TB treatment they get. And you can see that on figure 23, where if they have a positive chest x-ray finding of cavitation and the culture at 2 months after following the initial 4-drug treatment is positive, then those patients actually get a total of 9 months treatment. But if either the initial chest x-ray did not have any cavitation, it's okay if it has consolidation, but specifically not having cavitation, or the culture is 2 months is negative, then those people only get a total of 6 months of therapy.
Okay, great. Well, thank you for that. So, Arun, we know that consolidation, cavitation, central lobular nodules are sort of hallmark imaging features of active post-primary tuberculosis. Can we look at some CT findings that are associated with both active and inactive post-primary TB, nicely illustrated in figures 11 and 19 in the paper?
Okay, great. I think that's important to contrast the findings of active and inactive TB. So on figures 11, which has the chest x-ray and the CT, the arrows are pointing to consolidations. So we're seeing airspace opacities where we can, on the CT, we can see air bronchograms through them. And it's if it's a non-contrast CT, it would be hard to see the vessels through those areas of consolidation. The arrowheads are depicting cavities or rim opacities with internal lucencies. And those findings are easier to see on a CT, but the management pathways are really dependent on whether you see the cavitation on the chest x-ray. Now, for inactive TB, which we will see on figure 19, the chest x-ray and CT findings show scarring and retraction. And that's kind of the hallmark to think of fibronodular changes due to inactive TB. When you start to see evidence of retraction, the hilum is pulled superiorly, the arrowhead is pointing near areas of traction bronchiectasis with some bronchial wall thickening in those areas, and the arrow is pointing to what looks like a thin-walled cavity. And that's the problem with knowing for sure whether these patients with fibronodular changes and it might even look like a cavity, whether they are harboring any active TB.
Sure. Well, great. So going on to table 4, You provide a very nice template for the use in reporting the results of chest radiographs, which are obtained in patients with suspected latent or active tuberculosis. Can we look at this and have you review the pertinent components of the radiology report in this setting?
Sure, Jeff. So in table 4 is a sample report template, and it can be used for structured reporting. The findings and the impression are the only parts in the table. So I think it's important when we look at chest x-rays, especially in patients who it says evaluate for tuberculosis or employee health screening or patient is on TNF-alpha inhibitor type medication or immunosuppression, and so they're looking for those findings. They may not specifically mention that they want to look for TB. So keeping that in mind, we should always mention whether there is or not cavitation or consolidation or a nodular pattern. Those are all the kind of things that can be seen in active TB. And also to mention if there is or not fibronodular changes, because I think if we say that, then we would actually look for it. Mm-hmm. And that could be a finding in inactive TB. And also it's good to mention the presence of calcified granulomas, calcified lymph nodes, even though those specifically are not related to an increased risk for reactivation, but it's just kind of gives an idea. A patient obviously could have been exposed to other antigens like from fungus, histo, and sarcoid-related calcified lymph nodes, so it's not very specific. It's also good to mention mediastinal or hilar lymphadenopathy because that would be a feature of primary tuberculosis, and pleural effusion, which would also be a finding that could be seen in both primary and post-primary, a little bit more in primary. For the impression, we have a pick list of 5 choices, and so whichever one is applicable, you could choose. You would choose a no evidence of active or previous tuberculosis if there was absolutely nothing on the chest x-ray. If it's calcified granulomas alone, or calcified lymph nodes alone, you could say it's consistent with old granulomatous infection. And there's a slight wording use of choice here. Infection is more commonly used in the literature, at least clinically, for when there is a latent infection. And the word disease is used more in the clinical literature when there's actually been active disease or previous but now inactive disease. I think in radiology, we tend to use the terms interchangeably, but it might be preferable to use old granulomatous infection when we're talking about just a latent infection.
Sure.
The next one is stable fibronodular opacities for 6 months. If we can establish that, that would be great. And then you can just say it's inactive TB. But then if fibronodular changes are of uncertain activity because we don't have that previous chest x-ray, then, or we're not sure, then we could recommend that they obtain the imaging and provide it to us. And also, we could recommend that the clinicians do an evaluation for active TB.
Sure.
And I think it's important to communicate those findings to a referring provider. The findings that likely represent active TB, for those findings, we should recommend that the patients be isolated, respiratory isolation, and workup be done for active TB, like sputum sampling, and to communicate those findings as well. Some facilities have an infection control. And so these would be situations when you're notifying people, that would be a good place to notify, because the people at infection control, those personnel, they make sure that the ball isn't dropped and those particular patients are looked
after.
Yeah,
that's very, very important. Obviously, when you begin talking to folks in infectious disease and infection control and you raise the possibility of active tuberculosis, it obviously begins a process of fairly significant evaluation and management, which you don't want to take lightly, so that's very important. So, well, Arun, thank you very much for joining us. I'd like to thank Dr. Nachiappan for joining us today to discuss his paper in the current January 2017 issue of the journal.
Jeff, I'd like to thank you as well because you gave us the opportunity to present this in Radiographics, and we're very excited to be part of this.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.